we've been working on this exhibition for 2 or 3 years now, and the starting point really was always your experiences in Wolverhampton, growing up in Wolverhampton as a child. Could you tell me something about that and how that informed what the exhibition came to be?
Yeah, I grew up here. It's my hometown. And over the years that you and I have been talking about making this exhibition here, I've naturally been reflecting on the influences that affected me in my childhood and youth. And in that sense, the title of the exhibition, In a Landscape, is very much to do with the fact that I'm very conscious that I grew up between two landscapes, really. The industrial black country landscape. And I was born in 1951, so in the 1950s, when I was growing up, the black country was still incredibly productive, busy, industrial heartland. And then on the other hand, I was equally close to rural Staffordshire, as it was known then. And there were conduits, connections between these two landscapes, and those were the canals. And so walking the canals in one direction took me into deep into countryside, and going in the other direction took me into the middle of this heavy industry. That, I think, was a really extraordinary kind of edge to grow up in. And I think, at the same time, I just paint a little picture of the heart of Wolverhampton as it was then, which felt very much like a market town rather than an industrial city. Of course, it was both, but when the retail and wholesale markets were in the heart of the town, right next to St. Peter's Church, it gave a very strong sense of connection to agriculture and to the rural economy as well as the industrial one. So those influences, I think, have persisted a great deal, and some of the new work that I've made for the exhibition touches on those elements.
And I think also the collections here were a starting point, weren't they, for the discussions that we were having about the new work that you were going to make, and maybe you could say something about the collections that inspired you here, but also about your memories of the gallery as it was, because presumably it was an influence on you when you were as an art student.
Absolutely. Yes, the gallery as it was a very different place to the gallery as it is today. You know, these fantastic modern rooms that we're sitting in and that I'm privileged to be able to make the exhibition in, of course, were not here. A large part of the extension to the art gallery was a part of the art college at the time. And of course, the collections were in a very, very different kind of state in the early 60s to what has blossomed really since then. And I think I could probably sum it up by saying that when I was at school, for example, and I knew that I wanted to go to art school, and I was trying to look at art, I would come into Wolverhampton Art Gallery, and there were a great many 19th century rural views, genre paintings really. And while there were a small number of very strong paintings in the collection at that time, historical works, there were a large number of these. And I do remember standing in front of them and not being moved, not being stirred, or having any kind of sense of connection to this particular genre of painting, and thinking, why isn't something happening? You know, these are paintings. But there was a certain point in the 1960s when things really began to change, and I think the key moment was when David Rogers became director of the Art Gallery, and he began to collect contemporary art. And I'd never seen Bridget Riley, I'd never seen Richard Hamilton or Joe Tilson, and one day I came into the Art Gallery and he was this completely different experience. And of course, as many know, nationally and internationally now, that was the beginnings of the now famous Wolverhampton Pop Art collection.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's a very different a very different place, and the dynamic is fantastic now, and really generates a lot of energy.
Yeah, that's certainly something that is important part of the narrative of the history of the gallery, and you know, something that we're all well aware of the importance that David Rogers made in developing the collection. Just starting, I suppose, sowing seeds to what it's become now.
Well, I think that's true. And then at the same time, sort of overlapping, this fantastic contemporary sculpture arrived in the middle of Wolverhampton.
Oh yes, that was 1968, I think.
68. And that's in the shape of the wonderful Barbara Hepworth sculpture that was in the Mander Centre, and as we speak, it's now installed downstairs in Wolverhampton Art Gallery.
Yeah.
And I remember very well, who could forget if you were around at the time, the arrival of this phenomenal sculpture in the middle of town.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things I think that comes out of these reminiscences is the fact that that Barbara Hepworth sculpture has a lot of things in common physically with another monumental object in town.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, of course, there are quite a large number of glacial boulders in this part of the Midlands, left behind during the Ice Ages, when the ice retreated. But the monumental one is the standing stone in West Park. And as a child, I was fascinated by this enormous object, and I knew it came from the north, and I'd never been to the north. There's a plaque on it that suggests it came from Snowdonia, but I think modern geology thinks that it's from Galloway, much further north in Scotland. And I had a rather a magical feeling about this stone when I used to look at it. I had a kind of imaginary sense that when the glacier withdrew, it left it exactly where it is today, and that it had never moved, and everything around it had changed. The whole world had changed. But, of course, that was just in my imagination. But it was only recently, as we've been developing this exhibition, that I really recognized that this stone is almost exactly the same height as the Barbara Hepworth sculpture.
Mm-hmm.
And the Hepworth sculpture is called Rock Form, Porthcurno in West Cornwall. And here in West Park is another rock form with a very similar patina, very similar proportions. And what interests me about this, and I hope that this comes through in aspects of the exhibition, I'd like to draw attention to this, is making connections between different things that don't seem to have anything in common. And so in West Park is this monumental boulder which was brought incredibly slowly from the far north, what is now Scotland, and deposited here in the Midlands. And millennia later, an object, the sculpture by Barbara Hepworth, with so many physical things in common, also travels here, not from the north, but the far west in Cornwall, and it ends up a short walk from a stone that's been here for thousands and thousands of years. This aspect of travelling, I think, connects with other things in the exhibition, and principally these are to be seen in a showcase next to the exhibition, are a group of extraordinarily beautiful Neolithic stone axes, axe heads. The thing that's very interesting about these axe heads is that the likelihood is that they were cut from jadeite stone, this incredibly hard stone, very, very high up. It's a site located by modern geologists and historians, very high up in the Italian Alps. And similar axe heads can be found all over what is now Europe and in numerous parts of what is of Britain. They were highly valued. They took immense amount of time to make because the stone is so hard. And modern archaeology really agrees that objects like these were not made to chop down trees. They were made as extremely refined and beautiful objects. And so exchanged as objects of value across Europe, and the examples that belong here in the collections of Wolverhampton Art Gallery are exquisite. And so the works that I have made from these objects that are small enough to hold in the palm of your hand, I've made some very large, very highly detailed photographic images of them, because what I wanted to really look at were the surfaces, these beautiful surfaces. And I have to admit, I had a very uncanny feeling making these very big prints, looking meticulously at these surfaces, and I realized that in the Neolithic era, possibly at 4000 BC or earlier, that the makers of these stones had their eyes had concentrated on these stone surfaces in polishing them and, mm-hmm. and making them. And here we are now able to to cast our own eyes on these on these things.
It's a powerful thought.
Yes, it is. Yes, I think so.
Just to step back a bit, I think it's always interesting for us when we work with artists with the collections, because you never quite know what the artist is going to be interested in, and sometimes it's not an obvious thing that has resonance with their work. Mm-hmm. And obviously you chose to work a lot with our industrial collections and local history. When you came to look at the collection, did you have anything in your mind about the sort of objects, or were you coming with a completely, clear approach to what sort of things you might be looking at?
I'm not sure I had a clear idea, did I? Can you remember?
I'm not sure I had a process of, looked at some of the collections in stores and some of the collections that we had on, available digitally,
but I
remember very quickly you sort of focused in, you seemed to know almost what you were looking for. You focused in quite quickly on things that obviously, did have an impact.
Well, that's true. I'm not sure I knew in advance, but sometimes when you see something, that's what you were searching for, even though you couldn't have named it before. And the Neolithic axe heads are an example. I can remember us looking up and seeing an archive box, and written on the side of the boxes, that's what it said.
Yeah.
And I said, wow, let's have a look at those.
And of course it's great that you chose to work with that collection, because it is one that, we haven't shown very much here.
Well, I'm very privileged to be able to have worked with these things. I mean, something that I didn't know was here, of course, but we've included it within the exhibition itself, is, I think, a very emotionally moving piece of steel. And it's called, I think, in the collection, the Last Pour of the Elizabeth Furnace Bilston. It's this object which consists literally of blobs of steel that have cooled down on top of each other in a totally abstract, irregular way, are literally the last droplets of steel that was emptied out of this vast furnace before it was decommissioned and closed down. That was one of many great furnaces that came to that sort of end here in the Midlands. And of course, as we speak, it's a very live debate right now in contemporary Britain, in the south of Wales, with the future of steel production there in the balance. And so I do find this object very moving, because it's a modest thing in its way, but the thought that these were the last droplets to fall from this great furnace makes it, I think, a very highly charged object.
Yeah.
And contemplating that, led in a slightly circuitous route to working with the glass department here in the art school within the university, with Simon Eccles in particular, who enabled the making of a series of casts, not obviously of steel, but of glass, but in a method that was typical of basic engineering casting backcountry, and that was to do with casting into sand molds. And I can remember looking down from the train between Birmingham and Wolverhampton, looking down from time to time on the approaches to Wolverhampton and seeing these sand casting yards where engine blocks would be cast before they were then machined up for car production in the area. So there's been a coming together, I think, of in new work for me, out of things that I remember from quite a formative year.
Yeah. And I suppose that the new works were, I mean, we went through several discussions, didn't we, about then other works to include, and that was a sort of evolving process as well, wasn't it?
Yes.
And so what we've got in the exhibition actually is not only the new works, but some, you know, works that go back, you know, many, many years, including one piece that you made as a student. So, you know, I'm interested to know a bit more about, you know, how you arrived at some of those decisions about other works to include, and just sort of what felt right alongside these new works.
That's a very important question to ask, really. A key moment for me in the conversation you and I have had about the formation of the exhibition, a key moment came when I heard a piece of music on the radio one morning. I turned on the radio, we've all done this, and there's a piece of music playing, and you think, oh, what's that? I don't recognize that. But this piece of music was a solo piano playing, and I just thought it was a beautiful thing that I was listening to, and I found I'd stopped what I was doing and sat down, and I paid a great deal of attention, really listened to it. It just grabbed me, as they say, you know, it really just affected me. And I discovered at the end, when the presenter explained, that this was by the American composer John Cage, and he'd composed it in 1948 at a marvelous center of creativity in South Carolina that was called Black Mountain College. And the title of this piece of music that I had been so affected by was In a Landscape. And so it's a homage to John Cage, and a modest gesture from me that I decided that should be the title of the exhibition that I was making with you. But it also it clarified the theme for me. And I think probably I realized for the first time in a very long time that although I work in different media and there are very diverse things and collaborative things with dancers that I make and I'm collaborating with other artists, that there is a thread to do with landscape. And that made me go back to looking at some very early things and thinking, well, where is the landscape in this? And indeed, what you're mentioning is a tiny little photograph that I took as a foundation student at Wolverhampton Art College in 1968. And it's what you might think was a very unpromising subject for a photograph. I remember completely that we were in our little group given college cameras and told to go out into the streets and take a roll of film, come back and learn to develop it. And this, the roll of film that I had, were all canal side pictures, and the only one that survived is it's a little corner of stagnant water with discarded bottles, a piece of wood, and clearly some oil floating on the surface, all visible in this black and white photograph. But I think something must have caught my eye, and I think probably what I would say was that what caught my eye was just the glint of light on these surfaces. and that for a moment there must have been a little moment of beauty mm-hmm. in this stagnant corner.
Yeah.
And so that's the earliest work in the exhibition.
Yeah.
And following on from that, there are carefully selected works, I think, from different periods over the last 40, 45 years that in different ways touch on this theme of landscape, which I'd say to kind of come full circle in a way, isn't to do with me seeing landscape in the way that the 19th century genre painters did, that I saw exhibited here when I was at school. You know, in a way, a lot of those works you would say were views. They're to do with the picturesque, they're to do with making compositions that you look at. And I think nowadays we probably have a more engaged sense of what a landscape is.
It feels like it's not more to do with our physical relationship with the landscape.
Exactly.
It's like, you know, indeed there's works in the exhibition where you use your own body as part to create that landscape.
Yes, that's right. That's right. Where edges of the body might resemble or echo. Not so much look like, but echo silhouettes or forms that might be within the landscape. But I think you're absolutely right about the physicality. I think in the modern world in particular now, we're much more aware of the landscape being something that we need to look after, to conserve. Our environmental anxieties, I think, are very real and very widespread. And so I think now we're more used to understanding landscape as somewhere we inhabit rather than something that we look at that's over in the distance.
David, thank you very much.
It's a pleasure, Marguerite. Thank you.